So it's unethical to do an experiment with a healthy human baby brain.
Right. So
for several years, scientists have relying on animal models. For example, we try to learn what happens in a mouse or in a monkey, and we extrapolate to humans. But as I pointed out, the human brain is so different from other species, so we need to understand how the human brain is formed. So here comes this new technology, which is a brain organoid. And a brain organoid is just the recapitulation of the human development inside the lab, using stem cells to grow every single step at these very early stages of neurodevelopment.
Let's explain what stem cells are, so this will make sense.
All right. Stem cells are cells that are immature. They don't have a fate defined yet. For example, in you have your skin cells, you have your blood cells, you have your brain cells. All these cells have names right now because they already acquire some kind of identity. In the early stages of the embryogenesis, you have stem cells that are not defined yet. They are just self-replicating, and they will give rise to progenitor cells that later will form all the tissues in the body. So these cells, we call them pluripotent stem cells because they can form any tissues of the body.
So if they're given the right instructions or stimulus, they could become liver or brain.
Right.
You don't
right.
know. So you figured out how to induce them to becoming brain.
Yeah, we are brain makers. we develop protocols and recipes, formulas that we can add on these stem cells and instruct them or fool them around to think that they are in the right environment to become the cell type that we want. And my lab has been optimizing these protocols to create what we call a brain organoid or a mini brain. Some people call them mini brains, because they're just a very miniaturized version of the human brain. So last year, we learned how to grow these organoids to create functional neural networks. So that's one step ahead. So now
we have to explain what the functional network is.
Right. A functional network is when neurons start to talk to each other and form complex nets of information. So that's how beginning of our cognition appears or arises in the early stages of neurodevelopment.
So the baby doesn't have all those connections.
The baby already have them, but they are not mature enough. And in the organoid, we never seen that before because we thought that it would be impossible to recreate that in vitro. And a brain organoid has intrinsic limitations. It's not vascularized, not all cell types are there. We don't even know if the conditions are the same condition as in uterus. So we were quite skeptical that the networks would appear in these brain organoids. But so science has evolved to the point where we could tweak this protocol and make them actually form these networks. So now we open the possibility to study conditions where the brain is intact, but the networks are not. For example, conditions like autism or schizophrenia. So we don't see a major neuronal loss or a neurodegeneration in autism or schizophrenia.
But the network
is defective. So the question is, can we use these brain organoids to find new drugs or eventual gene therapy to help people with this kind of neurological conditions?
So understanding normal, how it works, how it's supposed to work, helps you identify what to do in situations where it didn't work the way we want it to work.
Exactly. That's how we do it. We always compare the disease condition with the neurotypical. That's what we call disease modeling in a dish. So we're doing this right now.
I remember years ago I met an Indian sitar player, and he gave me music to play for my children. And I said, why shouldn't I listen to it? And he said that I never developed the neural connections to hear all the sounds because those were not made when I was a baby. Mm-hmm. And when I can make those networks. You speak Portuguese, and the sounds, I have to concentrate very hard to hear all of that. Uh-huh. But your neural network was exposed to that, and it was reinforced and created. So you're now looking at these kinds of networks that babies, that's how they learn and grow, yeah. And being able to develop them in a lab. So that's It's just, to me, amazing.
Yeah.
That you're able to do that in a laboratory.
And I think you now touch on other things which might be a little bit more complex. For example, we could use the same technology to make the same human brain more plastic or more adaptable or have more synapses or be more protective against neurodegeneration later in life. Would be nice to have a brain that is protected against Alzheimer's.
Yes.
So we can ask those questions and perhaps finding answers. And some of these answers might require early modulations of these networks at very early stages in development. So we, as a society, we have to discuss the ethical implications of those alterations.
As a parent, that's a tough question to think about, and in society, that's a tough question. I don't think we'll answer that today, but but it's an important question because science is about to give us those options,
right?
And sooner rather than later to decide that. I'm a pediatric ophthalmologist. We have children who have amblyopia that really can't be treated after you get older because the neuroplasticity is gone.
Right.
There are brain injuries that we'd love to be able to repair. I mean, there's so much that we'd want to be able to do that you could see you making a difference in.